And I just want to acknowledge that some of us today will maybe grieve by laughing at stories and having a good time. Others today might grieve only by crying, or others by being angry the entire time. Just want to encourage us that each of us is trying to connect, trying to bring some understanding and some perspective in the midst of all of this. So I want to encourage us to be gracious with one another, especially as family members, as you are dealing with so much, to give space for one another and to remember that none of us grieve perfectly. We all do things and say things that we will regret in this process, but let's continue to press towards one another. We need each other to get through this time. I want to read some different verses from the Bible, kind of from all over the Bible. It says, God is our refuge and strength, always ready to help in times of trouble. So we will not fear when earthquakes come and the mountains crumble into the sea. Be still and know that I am God. Do not be afraid when you go through deep waters. I will be with you. When you go through rivers of difficulty, you will not drown. When you walk through the fire of oppression, you will not be burned up. The flames will not consume you. For I am the Lord, your God, the Holy One, your Savior. For the Lord your God is living among you. He is a mighty Savior. He will take delight in you with gladness. And with his love, he will calm all your fears. He will rejoice over you with joyful songs. All praise to God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. God is our merciful Father and the source of all comfort. He comforts us in all our troubles so that we can comfort others. And then Jesus said, come to me, all you who are weary and carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you. Let me teach you, because I am humble and gentle at heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy to bear, and the burden I give you is light. That even when I walk through the darkest valley, I will not be afraid, for you are close beside me. You keep track of my sorrows. You have collected all my tears in your bottle. You have recorded each one in your book. My enemies will retreat when I call to you for help. Because this I know, God is on my side. At this time, we're going to have some of the family members that are prepared to share. If that's you, if you can make your way around the stage back here, and they're going to share just about their loved ones that are gone, that we're remembering their life, their memories. And then after the family shares a little bit, we're going to watch a slideshow together of all of these friends having fun in their lives. And then we have some friends that have prepared some memories to share, and they're going to do that as well. So again, families coming around the stage, and they'll come out here in a moment. Okay. So you guys can see here, you can watch right there.
Hi, everyone. I'm Jake. I was Maddie's boyfriend. Say thank you everyone for being here and just everybody involved in the investigation, helping, and just everybody showing the unreal support. And yeah, we really appreciate it more than we can show right now. So I was Maddie's boyfriend, and she brought me closer to Zanna and Kaylee. I knew Zanna actually before Maddie, and I met Kaylee through Maddie. And they always were amazing to be around. Just Zanna was always so energetic and happy and just a beautiful soul, and Kaylee was always so strong and driven, and just kind and really genuinely cared about everyone. I didn't get the opportunity to meet Ethan too many times, but from what I had heard from Maddie and all the other roommates, he was also a really great guy, and just none of these people deserve this. So I met Maddie her freshman year of college. We went to high school together, but I was a couple years older and didn't really get to meet her until she came to University of Idaho, and she got in to the Pi Phi house, and I had multiple friends in there, and they just really took Maddie under their wing, and just took her under their wing, and were showing, like, introducing them to everybody, and just were always there for her. She was always surrounded by a good group. But yeah, so I met her actually on her bid day of her freshman year. I don't necessarily think she was supposed to go out that night, but luckily she did, and I got to meet her that night. There were times throughout the that school year where we got to hang out and just kind of, I got to get to know her a little bit, but I didn't really realize that I was in love with Maddie until the summer of 2020. We went to McCall, and I got a boat that summer, and we got to spend a lot of time on the water, and we floated the river and just hung out every chance we got. And then when we went back to school, I lived in an apartment, and I would just always invite over the Pi Phi girls to get an opportunity to hang out with Maddie. We didn't go on our first date until Valentine's Day that next school year, and we went to the breakfast club in Moscow, but we didn't officially start dating until April 27th that year. Maddie was a perfectionist. A good story with that would be Kaylee and Maddie's birthdays. They were like a month apart, and Maddie's came first, and she would always get frustrated because Kaylee would always go all out and just make everything perfect for her, and it was like almost like a little competition between the two who could make their birthdays better, and I guess it was a repeating thing throughout the years of them knowing each other. Maddie was the best at spreading love to all those that were close to her. Every time I talked to her on the phone, she would end the conversation with, "I love you," and I would always say it back. She was always smiling and dancing and laughing, and she was really observant of things. She would point things out that she thought were cute, which was something usually pink or tiny. She always loved being comfy. Like if we're watching a movie or a football game or anything, she's got her comfy socks on, blanket, and was just always making the best of every situation. She was nice, she was funny, she was confident. She knew that she was like she knew her worth. I had to work for her. It was worth it. Just so confident. She knew that she was beautiful inside and out, but she was also humble about it.
Loved ones speaking about these students who, again, were killed back on November 13th at this Celebration of Life service. Some viewers going to be seeing a two-minute break.
When she asked, she was the type of person that when she asked you how your day was, it was genuine. She really wanted to know. Like, when I would talk to her, she could tell me about all of her friends and what they were up to. She was just always aware of everything. She was also, she was really funny. All her jokes really would come out of nowhere, and you'd have to do like a double take. Just be like, was that the cute little blonde girl that just said that? She would always express her love to everybody with words and hugs. She's a really good hugger. She was always someone for her friends, her family, me, and just really anybody that needed advice or a shoulder to cry on, or a person to hug. Maddie was the go-to for that. She always loved like the whole process of like in Moscow, just getting ready with all of her friends. She would be helping all of them do the makeup. And I'd just be sitting on the bed observing all these girls going, doing what they do. So Maddie was my best friend. She was the first person I talked to every morning and the last person I talked to before bed. But I was lucky enough to be able to explore life with Maddie for about 2 years. She was the one who knew me best, and she saw me at my highs and my lows. Just helped me through everything. She was always there for me, just pushing me to be better and to spread positivity. I think that's what she wanted. And she was the person that I loved the most, and she loved me the most too. And I know she would want us to be strong and be as positive and happy as we can through this time. And just know that we have her watching over all of us. And I know she's in heaven, and I can't wait to see her again and just give her a big hug. That's all I got. I love you, Maddie.
Thank everyone for coming tonight. We really appreciate it. Maddie has truly been a blessing in our lives. Watching her grow and mature into the amazing woman she became is truly priceless in our hearts. She was the world to us. Maddie was such an easygoing, loving child growing up. She was patient and relaxed, patient and relaxed toddler most of the time. And as a teenager, she didn't really give us many worries or trouble. Anyone who knows our family knows that we're Steelers fans. I know. Favorite memory for me was watching the game with her. And every time the Steelers scored, I'd pick her up and I'd hold her high in the air and we'd celebrate together. And she'd always just laugh so hard at that. We'd just crack up and have a great time. She loved the water. She always looked forward to going boating and fishing with her papa, her Uncle Dave, and Aunt Nadine. She loved going on the boat with her friends and her boyfriend Jake, and we hardly ever saw her during the summer for the most part. Maddie was always inquisitive, curious, and eager to learn about everyone and everything. She absolutely loved younger children in her life, adored all animals, and never said no to any type of family gathering. Maddie loved to travel, especially with her best friend Kaylee and her family. They were both in love with life and exploring. That's why they hit it off so well when they met. They were inseparable from the sixth grade on. They were truly sisters, and our families grew bigger and better from that. The two of them were a force not to be reckoned with. They stuck together through everything. Maddie had such a bright future, as all these kids did. The world is a darker place without them, but the light of their love and memories will always guide us all. Thank you all for joining us in this celebration of life of these beautiful souls. We love you, Maddie, Kaylee, Santa, and Ethan. Thank you.
I want to thank you guys all for coming here today. This is the Gonzalez family. We got Jack up here. And I want to thank Zana's family for putting this together. I didn't have to pick up the phone. I didn't have to write an email. I didn't have to do anything. And I know that an event like this large with all these things took a lot of people, and they volunteered their time. And we want to thank who you know, if you were a part of this. I can't say everyone by name, but I want to thank you. We're going to say a couple stories about our girls and help you guys understand how much we love them and how we miss them and how we hope this community can get strong and heal and mainly just understand what we lost and how much the world has lost with these two girls and these other three girls and Zion and Nathan. All right, my wife will read a poem that she had on her page, Kaylee, and here you go.
He came across this. Going through Kaylee's stuff. It's called Milk and Honey.
Most important is love, like it's the only thing you know how. At the end of the day, all of this means nothing. This page, where we're sitting, your degree, your job, the money, Nothing even matters except love and human connection. You, who you love, and how deeply you love them, how you touch the people around you, and how much you give them. Reflection was getting me.
Kaylee was our middle child out of five. She was always competitive. She was smack dab middle, so Stephen and Olivia were a little bit older. Audrey and Aubrey were a little bit younger, so she kind of had to figure out where to fit in, and she definitely did. There was never a day that she didn't want to race her brother because she was determined that girls were faster than boys, or that she didn't want to go bug her little sisters and make sure they knew that she was older and they were the little sisters. Kaylee is a huge part of our family. The dynamics of our family will never be the same. We know that this is God's will. It's hard to accept. But she was a beautiful girl. She started junior high with Maddie, as you all knew, and our family became six very quickly. You know, there was a lot of friends throughout this family that came and gone and went and whatever, and we're still friends, but we don't see them that much. That wasn't Maddie. Maddie and Kaylee were by each other's side every day. They went to other countries together. Karen took them to Hawaii together. We took them to Mexico together. They went to college together. They went to high school together. They lived in their own apartment together. They were sisters. She was one of ours. And we're just heartbroken. And we know it. It's just going to take time for everybody to heal. If that's possible. I just pray that it is. Thank you, everybody.
Want to say anything? We're going to share just a little bit of a story so you could understand how Kaylee was. My father, who also passed away this year, he's that guy that sits in the lazy boy chair and has the controller and owns the room. Well, when he wasn't looking, he'd go probably get himself a beer or something, and Kaylee would grab his controller and pull the batteries out of it and go hide them. She was 2 years, 3 years old. My dad would rant and rave that somebody was hiding the batteries, and we just thought he was kind of losing his mind. Because it was happening like four or five different times, and Kaylee would just sit on the couch with a big grin on her face and just watch what my dad would do and how upset he would get. And I believe that's around the time that my dad named her K-Bug.
Bug-ass.
Because she bugs everyone. And it stuck because it was appropriate. She wasn't perfect. She was our little girl. She was ornery, and we loved her for that. You know, it was okay that was her signature, and nobody tried to change her.
Another thing. Similar to the battery story, back in the day when we had cordless phones, you know, three or four throughout your house, going to my sister's, her favorite thing to do was to throw them in the toilet. So she would tell me, "Christy, Kaylee threw the phones in the toilet again." I'm like, "I'm sorry, sissy. I'm sorry. Can we dry it out? Is it done? Was it clean water?" I don't know how many phones I had to replace because for whatever reason, she would throw those cordless phones in the toilet.
Oh gosh, so I'm Olivia. I don't even know if I need this mic. I have a loud voice. I apologize. I'm Kaylee's older sister. And I mean, everyone's kind of said it. She was kind of a pain in our butts, but she was our pain in the butt, and we loved her. But one story that I've for whatever reason, thought about when I walked up here, and I haven't thought about in a long time. It was one time my sister came to me and she said, "Olivia, I think I got something stuck up my nose." And I said, "Whatever, what do you mean you have something stuck up your nose?" She said, I feel like there's something stuck up there." So I go and I press on her nose, and there's a really hard lump in there. So I'm like, "We're gonna have to go talk to Mom. This is serious." So we take her up to Mom, and sure enough, she had a bead stuck up there. So we wind up going over to our aunt's house, Aunt Tammy, to kind of try to fish out this bead. And eventually we get it out, and we ask her, we say, "Kaylee, how did you get that bead up your nose?" And she goes, "I don't know. It must have popped up there when I fell off the bed." And I don't know why I thought of that story. I don't know what it says about her, but that was one of my favorite stories of Kaylee.
She was a turd.
Family members here are sharing some emotional but also some happy stories here at this Celebration of Life service. We're going to continue listening, and some viewers going out, though, to a two-minute break.
Working through together, you really have to just take care of each other. You got to reach out and hug the people, make yourself uncomfortable, and just be part of the healing and take advantage of every opportunity that you can tell your child that you love them. Don't let them walk out that door without giving them a hug. Even if they're annoyed and they don't want you and you're embarrassing, just say, "I'll hug you longer if you just don't get this over with." So it's going to take that. If this community is going to help us, we all know that we can't do it alone. So, and I thank you guys all for here and starting that process right here in our own little community. Thank you, guys.
Hi, I'm Jazzy, and I'm Zana's sister. First, I want to thank you all for coming. It's really nice to see so many familiar faces and so many people that had so much love for Zana, Ethan, Kaylee, and Madison. Zana was such a light in my life and so many others. She was a person I could relate to the most, and she knew and understood me more than anyone. Losing her is the hardest thing I've ever had to go through, and it has left me heartbroken. Zana was the funniest person I knew and made me laugh every time I spent time with her. I have so many memories and stories I could share about her, but I know remembering the times I had with her brings me so much joy and happiness. Everyone thought we were twins growing up, and I remember in some of our last moments together, we were in her room laughing in the mirror because neither of us thought we looked alike, and her friends just laughed. She was my baby sister, but she was so much wiser and experienced so much more in life than I ever have. She never let an opportunity pass her by and enjoyed all the moments she had. She was always doing something fun, and in any situation, it was always so much more fun with Zana there. I remember I would get so mad because I always thought my friends liked her more than me, but she was a person that everyone enjoyed being around. She was so positive and lighthearted and understood the gift of life more than anyone I know. I remember her getting so mad at me for caring about the little things that didn't matter. She would always tell me she wouldn't know what to do without me, and now I have to live this life without her. I know she would want me to cherish the times I have with the people I love. She would want me to make the most out of every situation. She would want me to have fun, continue my journey in life, and constantly tell people how much I love them and they mean to me. I remember going to hang out with her about a couple months ago. I remember telling her that we should try to do a sister date every week to spend more time with each other before I graduate. I remember her loving the idea, and her friend Ella reached out to me and told me that Zana was so happy that we were going to start doing that. I love her so much, and I wish I would have spent more time with her and had the chance to continue spending time with her. I know she loved living in her house in Moscow with her friends. I would hear so many stories about her and her roommates, and it made me so happy to know she had such great friendships. She really knew everyone and was friends with everyone. She had the best friend group and had friends in so many different sororities, fraternities, and organizations. I was so happy she was dating Ethan, and Ethan was such an amazing person. Xana never had a boyfriend before, and my dad and I wondered if she was ever gonna get one. Ethan was that special, though, because I know she was picky with boys. They were always so happy, and the way she would talk and smile about him was something I've never seen her do before. She truly loved him so much, and I know he had so much love for her. They had something so special, and everyone around them knew. It's comforting to know that they're all watching down on us from heaven now. Casey Johnson is a best friend of ours, and her mother, Susie Graham, was like a mom to us. Susie had a long fight with breast cancer and unfortunately passed away last year. Casey texted me a couple weeks ago saying, "I know Xana isn't alone up there in heaven. I feel my mom in the sunshine, and yesterday the sun went through my window and fell right on her urn. I think that's her way of telling me that she's got Xana and that she's made it up there to heaven. That gave me a little bit of peace, and I want to share that with you." This text made me so happy and helped comfort me a lot. I know they are all in the best place together, and one day we will all be reconnected. I am so thankful for faith, friendships, and family through this and everything else. Xana, you will not be forgotten. You have impacted so many lives and have given people so much love. I hope I can make you proud and try to leave an impact on this world and on people like you did. I love you so much, Xana, and I hope you're feeling the most happy, content, and loved in heaven right now.
I'm Jeff and Xana's dad, and I think that Jasmine pretty much said it all, you know, everything that needs to be said, except for, you know, we're going to miss her. We're going to miss her more than anybody knows, and I know a lot of you people, the ones that know her, are going to be right there with us. It's going to be a tough road. It's that kid. It's just, she shone light to the day. When you see her, and she taught me a lot of stuff. She taught me how to be a dad, and I didn't know that until she was gone, you know? It's like, Xana, you taught me something. I didn't know that. She's like, it became the woman that she was gonna become at the, you know, the last weekend I saw her, which was a week before that. She was taking care of the house. She was taking care of things. She took my keys from me and said, "You had too much to drink, Dad. You can't drive. We'll get you a ride to your hotel." She was being the mom to all the kids and the girls. And I was really happy to see her there happy. And that's what I remember that weekend, is her being happy with the other girls, taking care of stuff. The house was beautiful, taking care of everybody. Everything was just about as good as it ever could have been in my picture as a parent. What it was going on in U of I, good grades. So I can remember that. Doesn't make it better, but it makes it a little bit easier. You know, to know that it wasn't like it was a, you know, there was issues, because there was, it wasn't. We'll never know, you know. So, anyways, that's all I got, and thanks everybody for coming. And we're good.
Thanks everyone for coming. My name is Kim, and I am Xana's aunt. And I'm gonna give you my testimony today. At first, when we heard of the news, I was so angry that she was taken away, all these special people. And you never think it's gonna happen to your family. And then I had to sit back through my tears and realize that I really was blessed. I was fortunate to have Xana live with me for a couple years. And the memories I wanna share are funny. My kids were grown, and I had Jasmine and Xana for a while. And I'll never forget the time I go into the bathroom. I don't know if you remember this. and she found my Crisco, and she wiped it all over her body like it was body lotion, everywhere, all over the bathroom. Thank goodness there's Simple Green. Needless to say, I just thought, I couldn't believe it, you know, how you do. And another fond memory I have is we'd go to bed at night, and I lived in a house that the floor would squeak. And Jasmine would go, "Aunt Kim, Xana won't go to bed. And she's keeping me up." So I'd get out of bed, and our floor would creak. And you could hear her little feet run to bed. And after a while, it became a game. I never even went to check on her. All I had to do was get up, and she'd hear the floor creak. And then she became a teenager, and I saw less of her. But I do have the fond memory of her coming, calling me. She still called me then and said, "Aunt Kim, it's the prom or a dance. Can we go get our nails done?" So I have those beautiful memories to share of going with her to get our nails done. And then she went off to college. And I don't know, I saw or I heard less and less. Once in a while, she'd text me back, but not too often. And I know she was busy with her life. I mean, you know, we were all that age once. And then I heard that she found Ethan and fell in love. And at that point, I thought to myself that I'm so glad she found love, because we all really don't know what love is until we love. And as short as her life was, I'm glad she got to have that experience. And through all this, like I had a whole bunch of stuff in my mind, but through all this, I hope we can all look through that dark tunnel and see the light and follow that light. And I pray that we have justice someday. I say these things in Jesus' name. Amen.